All right, guys. The recording has started, and as we have discussed today, we're discussing the book of Esther, and this is week number 37 or lesson number 37. So today we have yet another love story. And last time we really enjoyed the book of the book of Song of Songs, and it became one of my best books until the next one. So, you know, it's like every time when we're reading a new book, it just becomes the best. And, you know, I've said that, you see, love stories are always, you know, very interesting. And this one, I believe it beats all these love stories like the Cleopatra and Mark Antony and the famous Paris and Helen of Troy. And that Dante and Beatrice, you know, if you know the story of Dante and Beatrice, the guy who even goes to hell for his woman, it's quite interesting. So, you know, in Song of Songs, we dealt with Solomon and his true beloved. So, yeah, so today it's a yet another interesting story of Hadassah and Xerxes, you know, and yeah, so we are in our last book of the scrolls. As you remember, that we've got the so-called the writings in English, and in the Hebrew Bible or the Tanakh, you know, this is the Kevum. The Ketuvim, sorry. So they're divided into three, as you know. And under the Ketuvim, you've got all of those, the three poetry books, the five scrolls, and the history books. So, you know, these five scrolls are very, very important as well. They are very authoritative in the Jewish kingdom that we've been called to come into. They are celebrated in all the festivals, starting from the Passovers. They read these books in the synagogues. So these are quite important books. You know, sometimes when you're reading them, you ask yourself, what are they doing in the Bible? Like Song of Songs, what are you doing in the Bible? But they are as much scripture as the rest of the books. And, you know, one of the things that we're going to be discussing in our coming seminar is this whole issue of Greek mindset that has created these spiritual things and separating what is so-called spiritual and physical. But in the Hebrew mindset, everything is combined. God is so much into everything in the same way. You know, so the physical things are that much important, but we'll deal with them in detail when we get them. So you don't think men and women and love stories and all this thing, God is not involved. God is only involved in so-called spiritual things and church things. And, you know, that comes from the Greeks. Yeah, in the true faith, we do everything combined. So you can see that we're still in that time of the pagans, and and our Jews are sent back. They are freed. They are no longer slaves as they were in Babylon. Pagans are more liberating. So we've seen that Darius actually allowed these Jews to go and rebuild their temple. So if you remember, he sent Zerubbabel and Yeshua, you know, they were sent by King Darius, and they went from there. Remember now, the capital is no longer Babylon because it's the Persians now. So the capital is Susa, which is going to play even an important role today, because that's where the King of Kings stay. So the guys, they've moved and they've traveled back to Jerusalem there in that white outlined them, and they're rebuilding the temple. So it's still, everything is still red because they're still under the Persian Empire. So all these countries are just now colonies, or as they call them, you know, they'll place a governor, like Zerubbabel was a governor then, you know. So it's just a province. That's another word that they'll use, you know, just like us in South Africa. We were under the British Empire, and South Africa was just one of those colonies. They may put their governor here as they wish, but everything is ruled in London by the king or the queen. So it's the same story here. So we are going to learn more even about this son of Darius that is called Xerxes. And as I've said, we are going to be focusing on that place that we have called Susa, that is called Susa. So when Darius died, obviously his son became the new king, and that was in 486 BC, became the new king of kings. So today we're going to learn that after Xerxes' wife Vashti was banished, he married this Jewish girl that is called Hadassah, and she became known as Esther. But just to give you a little bit of history so that we may lay this outline for the next coming weeks as well. When Xerxes died in 465 BC, he was killed by a commander of the royal bodyguards called Artabanus. You know, he was the most powerful official in the Persian court. So he's the actual one that assassinated King Xerxes with the help of some eunuch. But apparently, he accused one of Xerxes' son to have been the one who killed Xerxes. And that Xerxes' son was called Darius. Again, I told you guys there's too many of these guys, they keep repeating their names. So there's a lot of Dariuses, a lot of Xerxes and Artaxerxes, and you know, so don't confuse these people. So so this man who killed Xerxes actually accuses his son Darius, and then his other son called Artaxerxes actually murders in revenge that other son called Darius, but then later found out that actually it was this Artabas, and then he killed him too. So there's a couple of variations of stories when you're reading the history books, but at the end of the day, Artaxerxes became king in 465 BC. But then after 7 years of his rule, that is when he sent Ezra to go back to Jerusalem, and that is the second deportation. Remember we said that they move in three stages, and then after another 7 years, he sends his cupbearer, Nehemiah. So Ezra goes with the priests, and Nehemiah also goes with another load. So just as they came in three depots, they also returned in three depots as well. So we are going to study those other books in the next coming sessions. But then we shall also cover the book of Malachi, which happens around the same time, because Ezra is going there with the priests. And you're going to see that Malachi is going to be discussing a lot of corruption that is happening during that time. And we've discussed last week that actually, you know, there's a new kind of leadership, which is the leadership of the priests. We've seen through Yeshua that instead of the governor the son of David, Zerubbabel, to be crowned, Yeshua was crowned. So he became both the king or the prince and the priest. So we started the royal priesthood that we discussed in detail last week. But in Malachi, we are going to be digging deep on what is happening at that time. So we shall finish as well after Malachi, because it's the last prophet and the last book of the Tanakh. And then we're going to go to finish the year by discussing that 400 missing years when the Greeks come into the scene from around 313 BC. This is when a whole lot of nonsense started coming in, which I will also cover in our seminar. Please come through. We're starting tomorrow and we're ending on Thursday. So I'm going to give more details about what happened and why we've got false Christianity today because of these Greeks that came during that time, which is not in the Bible. And all of a sudden, you can see that even the writers in the New Testament, they are writing in Greek. How did that come about? So we're going to discuss more about that. Now, let's come to the book of the day, the book of Esther. We're not too sure who wrote it, but it starts with an interesting story about this King Xerxes that is also called Ahasuerus. It was hard for me to actually
Hi, Oscar. I'm not sure if it's me, but I can't hear you anymore.
No, something's wrong with. I think he's gone off with the mic that he was using.
Okay. Can you guys hear me?
Now we can, yeah.
Hello?
Yeah.
We can hear you now.
You had gone quiet.
Guys, can you hear me? I lost the.
Yes, Oscar.
Can somebody signal us?
We can hear you now. We can hear you.
Okay. First, yeah, I think this phone thing is going to be a problem. I thank God somebody did make a call, because when they make a call, it cuts everything. So I actually declined that call, but still it just kicked out Zoom. So I'm just gonna continue with the laptop. So I was saying that the name of this king is Ahasuerus. So don't be shocked. So some versions you'll be seeing that name, and in some you'll be seeing Xerxes. So it's still the same person. I'm also trying to log in so I can see what you guys see so that we may be on the same page. So now the story, you know the story, you know, in his third year now, King Xerxes, threw a feast with all these officials and nobles and governors, and he was busy showing off all of his glory and his powerful riches and everything, you know. So Queen Vashti also threw her own party for the women that that are under Xerxes as well. And you know, on one of the days, while he was excited because he's showing off, he decides, as you know the story, to call Vashti to show off her beauty, but she refused. And at the end, you know the story, he ended up punishing her. The question is why? Why did he banish her? Maybe just to give you also some lead in the interest of the time that is already gone. You know, I've seen posts from even, and some preachers are changing the narrative now. I saw one of the pastors from some previous church I used to go to, who leads this gender equality ministry. And she was saying, you know, Vashti, you know, Vashti was right. You know, women shouldn't be seen as property. And, you know, that was like some kind of woman abuse. So do you guys agree with a statement? What is your take?
I don't agree with that statement. I mean, I just think that's where we make mistakes, to try and fill in the gaps. We don't know what the culture was in those days, if, you know, it was right for the king to parade the wife. And parading the wife, I've also heard a narrative that she was supposed to have worn seductive clothing and then come and show the other men. But it's just all, you know, hearsay. And if that was the culture of the day, you know, to bring the wife must come so everyone must clap or admire her beauty, then so be it. It was the culture of the day. I don't think it was abuse.
Hello.
Yes.
Yeah. I also have to disagree with the statement because of one particular matter. For me, I think reason why this is just my thought and opinion on it, because God and obedience. When we talk about God, God talks a lot about obedience. And when I look at it, I'm looking at it in a point where the queen was disobedient to the king's command. And that's where the punishment came from. You know, where that, you know, you were disobedient to my command, not just my command as the king, but my command as your husband. That's why I'm thinking about it. But regarding that it's gender, what and so forth, I disagree on that one.
Okay, I'd like to also hear more from the women. And another, bearing in mind, né, when it comes to the wisdom books, né, unlike these other books where, you know, you can just go and take a story and try to apply it to yourself. Wisdom books, you can apply it to yourself. They are made for that, you know. They give you wisdom. So here you must also be looking at something. So it's, we're trying to find it relevant, the relevance of it as well in our in today's time, to say, now I'm reading this, you know, how do I view this man demonstrating me as a property of beauty and whatever, you know? So can I hear from the ladies as well? Was this pastor, in inverted commas?
Yes.
All right. Exactly. Does she have a point?
Yeah. Isn't it then? Well, there was no equality, gender equality in those days, right? So, but I think throughout we've been reading that wives are meant to be seen by their husbands only. Is that not going against that as well?
That's an interesting view and question as well. But from reading this, it does not seem like he was demonstrating I would doubt if he was demonstrating her sexuality and demonstrating her naked and all that. But
hi, Oscar. Yeah, I'm also not talking about sexuality or anything, but I mean, we read about a woman must cover and, you know, only husband should see the beauty or whatever. I mean, obviously I'm paraphrasing a lot of it and maybe even misquoting, but I don't see a reason why he had to do that apart from him being him.
Mm. Rachel, you're very low, hey? Please speak up. You are undercover. Speak up, please.
Okay, but I think we did get it. Unless if she wants to continue. Yes.
I think there's two things that we should be mindful of, guys. Ne? There's you introducing your partner so that people can meet your partner. And there's you now parading your partner as if she's some lovely painting on the wall that they can admire. Those are two different things. Because apart from just her aesthetic beauty, there's more to her than just being paraded. So I think that's what made her angry. This is your partner. Introduce your partner to whoever is sitting there, you know, the important people that she needs to meet. It's an introduction, but not for you to just come and parade so they can see how beautiful you are. And then maybe what's going to happen? Oh, she's lovely. And she's your queen. She's a queen at the end of the day. And I think she deserves some sort of a respect. So remember as well that if you, now I'm just going to go a bit further. The difference between Esther and Vashti was that, and the way I think Esther communicated with her husband, she was always, you know, subdued and quiet and, you know, if it pleases my Lord and whatever, but he also gave her that respect as well. So remember, respect is a two-way street. So I think maybe the one part we don't know of that's not documented is their relationship and how, you know, the communication was between the two of them. Because if you look at how he always, whenever Esther had a request, you know, she'd humble herself and she would say what it is that she wanted and he would oblige and he would do that just to keep her happy as well. So, yeah, I don't know what happened, like communication, yeah, how it was, but just from her saying no, clearly there was something that was annoying her.
Oscar, before the other ladies come in, on Simangla's point, she's making a good point, but then also to throw the spanner in the works, we shouldn't try and compare our relationships today with those guys then. And also throwing the spanner in the works in what Rachel was saying, these are not Christians. They didn't know God. You know what I mean? So the way, and remember with the wife, it wasn't one man, one wife in these days. The man had what they call a haram was, I've forgotten what that word is. He had a room or he had a side room full of concubines. So he wasn't obliged and to stay with the wife every day. So it's not like the kind of relationships we have today. But I like what Simangele is saying. We don't know what kind of relationship they had. Maybe she was married to him and she didn't want him. There is even some historians that say that Vashti is the granddaughter of Nebuchadnezzar, those guys there. So already they must have said she was brought up in a spoilt manner already. She was brought up in riches and marrying this one. So there's a lot of stuff. But anyway, yeah, let's listen to what the women are saying.
Hi.
Yes.
My take on it is from a woman's perspective, Vashti refusing based, I don't know, on whatever. I personally, if someone was drunk and they call you because they want to parade you, and maybe he's been doing that for years, it's irritating. Because let's give an example. Maybe he didn't call her the whole month and is just calling her that night, you know? It feels like that's what she's good for. Because even the Bible says she was good to look at, you know, that was her gift, her beauty, you know. So from a woman's perspective, it's not nice to be like defined by one thing. However, in as much as you feel that way, in terms of her role as a wife and her office as a queen, she shouldn't have refused. That was not the time to air her grievances or her irritation or whatever. So her refusal, I don't think it was correct, but her feelings that led to the refusal might be understandable. That's my take on it.
Yeah, it's getting more interesting. Any more ladies? Michelle, I know you want to drop something on this. Maureen, where are you?
This is Michelle. So I've got a lot of views, but I think the one thing that I noticed about Vashti was, I don't know who was talking about disobedience and God. So I got that after I read it in my own eyes, because in my own eyes, what I saw was her arrogance. And I think that's what pissed off the king. That's how I see it. You know, it wasn't really that she refused to go, but the arrogance in which she refused to go, I think is what really caught my eye. The arrogance and the disobedience. Because I don't know who just finished talking, but yeah, she could have just gone and dealt with this in a better way, or spoken to him after, as us women do all the time here. But that's just my view, the disobedience and the arrogance.
Esh, Maureen, if you can hear us, you've got a bad network there. We can't hear you, but maybe we should move. Tanta, did you want to say something before we move on?
Just one, not too much, just a little bit.
Maureen is back.
Yeah, maybe it's
Maureen. No. Maureen, if you can hear us, your thing, we can hear you. I've got a very bad feedback. Yes, Tanta, sorry, you can just type. Perhaps someone will be able to read it.
Because we've been crucified, women, we've got this mentality that we can fight for our rights and we can tell men how we feel. But in those days, it's amazing how even non-Christians or non-Jews used to do marriage as God commanded, you know. So it was wrong of Vashti to decline when the king summoned her. In those days, when you are a woman, you were you had to submit under your husband, and whatever your husband says goes. So it was wrong of her. I think because we've been crucified as women, we've got different views of how women should be treated. And in those days, what the husband said goes. So it was wrong of her, because she knew who she married and she knew the culture of the marriage of those days.
Yeah, she had no wisdom.
No. Yeah, hey, those are big and serious words. And I see Maureen also posted that. Oh, can somebody read it? Because once I clicked that, I only saw it when it was appearing that she... if somebody can read it, because once I click the chat. Yeah,
that's fine. I read it. She said, first of all, she's saying there's no electricity there. Maybe it's a network. And then she says, I don't see anything wrong with the request from the king.
Yeah. So Thank you guys for your views as well. It's a complicated thing, and you know, and there is some form of wrong, possibly with the way the king has done it. And like you said, we don't know the background story, you know. But the biggest question was, despite that wrong, you know, we've been given this story and to show disapproval of her action. I'm going to skip one slide, and let me just go to that one there that I think will highlight this properly. Because the advisors to the king now, somebody actually mentioned the, I think it was Sviso, you know, because the biggest issue here, what was wrong with it? And as Michelle said, her lack of wisdom, and someone also mentioned her characteristics, maybe she's also spoiled and whatnot. And there's somebody also who also compared her to Hadassah, you know. Guys, in all relationships, you know, you're always going to find, someone is always going to be wrong, you know, but it's the way in which you actually have to respond, you know. She did not respond wisely, whether what the king was doing was wrong or right. There's correct ways. But when you look at the way Hadassah does things, she obeys and she knows, she humbles herself, you know. If it pleases my king, you know, she could have went and said, if it pleases my king, or do whatever, and then go in her chambers later on, whatever, and say, if it pleases my king, this is how I felt. And, you know, the king has got powers, and he likes being the man. You know, he could always have gone back and say, from now on, the queen shall be treated in this way and no more, but you know, you'll give it. But this one is just doing things in front of all these other women. Now, this was crucial. She's the queen. She's holding a certain position. And the problem with that is that now, her behavior, it's now going to cause a very big problem that women will now start to be, to treat their husband with contempt, you know, because now she's got that position, and this is where the problem is. Why will that be a problem? Now, because when I'm looking at this, I'm trying to think, okay, so now why is this thing in the Bible? And this is the verse that actually gave it away, you know. So in God's eyes, this is what is the problem. Because now, if women start to treat their husband with contempt, it's a problem. Whether their husbands are wrong or right, you know. Now, we're speaking about things of authority and stuff, you know. Also, us guys, let's be honest. You know, God does treat us in some way that we feel it's not right. You know, God can take someone that you love. You know, you can pray for something and then you don't get it. In fact, let me give you the hardest one of them all that I can. You know, God can make you barren. Scripture is very clear. It is not the devil, it's not, it is God who's making people barren. So now, does that make you want to treat God with contempt? You know, we are encountering things all the time, and we know God is in control. We've been studying the Tanakh, and we see God has got all the power, and nothing happens without. So now, do you go and treat? So there's an issue here about authority, you know, and how to treat. And because we're crucified and we listen to this crucified gospel, which it's all about us, you know, we have got no understanding of godly ways. and the Jews and these people that you are saying, they're seemingly it's that culture, that culture, that, no, that is the way of God. These people are still in the best ways of God. What the Greeks have brought, which I'm going to show you as we continue, the Greeks have just messed up the world, giving us these things of rights and all these things. But if we are to say we are believers, we are actually being grafted into these kind of things. And in these kind of things, you know, there's even scriptures like this that, you know, if you are crucified, you are going to have a serious problem when you're reading this. And this is being written to the crucified Greeks of Corinth, who were actually feminists. This, if you want to know, these were exactly like us. You know, this is the Corinthians were, you know, a great reflection of what we are in today's society. And Paul wrote this to deal with them. And he's saying, for a man ought not to cover his head, since he is the image and the glory of God, but the woman is the glory of man. You know, there's a way in which a man is expected to behave because he is the glory of man and he's under God's authority. And there's a way a woman has to behave because she's the glory of a man. And this is where it's going to pinch you in your crucified mindset. Verse 8, for a man was not made for a woman, but a woman was not made from woman, but woman from man. Neither was man created for a woman, but woman for man. That is why a wife ought to have a symbol of authority on her husband. So, you know, because the angels of guys, the point that is being made here, it's very hard for these Corinthians, the same way it is for us. And that glory, you know, why I even picked this thing up. The man was showing off his glory, the glory of his riches, the glory of his. And then it's, you know, the biggest of his, all of his glory, it was this woman, you know. He's showing his glory. And then she dishonored him, you know, in front of everyone. Now that man, you know, there's nothing that can kill a man and humiliate a man than when his woman dishonors him, you know. And by the way, you know, she was beautiful. And I like the way the scriptures, you know, I can even go back to it. I like the way that scripture, it actually, you'll even see it with Esther. She's beautiful. She was lovely to look at. God intentionally made women to be beautiful. You saw even with the first one, the man was crazy. Yo, flesh of my flesh, what is praising her? We've seen the Song of Songs, we're not gonna go back there. Women, where you were created specifically to be beautiful. You know, it's not coincidental that a man sees you and he goes crazy. This is also very central to this book. Because you see the man, a king of kings, the man who conquers the whole world, who owns Amon, most powerful man in the world. But he's got this thing for this woman. This woman has got, you know, if in today's time we will say this woman has poured Corovella. This man could do anything for this Hadassah. You'll see it later on. You have seen it when you're reading. He'll say, ask me anything, even half of my kingdom. Who does that? You know? He even allowed there, when we're closing the book in chapter 8, to do some fairy stuff that, I mean, that's how much power this woman had for her beauty. Does God recognize beauty? Of course. You know, is everybody beautiful in God's eyes? I don't think so. You know, one of the things that we're learning here, guys, is to be real when we're reading scripture. You know, and you remember as well the story of Leah and Rachel. Rachel was beautiful, Bible, you know, it's specifically mentioned. It's beautiful. And the other one, because she was not so beautiful, God actually, because he's fair and he's righteous, the other one, he gives beauty. And then the other one, because she was not beautiful and she was being mocked for it, he made her be fruitful. He made the other one who's beautiful to be barren, fair and square. You know, so these things are real, and we are studying this to study God, you know, so we mustn't have this imagined God in our likeness that we've created, who loves everybody, who sees everybody as beautiful, who has got equality and all this. It's us. We are here to unlearn, and let's take God for who he is, you know. So, you know, he's, and that Corinthians is actually telling us, you know, I'm not going to spend too much time on this thing. We really need to understand this, why we're created, you know. And this king, when he's creating a woman, he had no plans to create woman. He has told the angels why he has not given them women, you know. And for a man, he has created women, you know, to for them to help them procreate, you know, and to be their helpers, you know. So now the problem with today is now we've got all these people that are really, you know, the Greeks have really brought this democracy, and, you know, I'll discuss it later. But, you know, but the woman, guys, if you are to be true believers of this faith and you want to be the women of God, you know, be like Sarah and understand your place. You know, you've been created for a man. You know, you're not being created to be independent and to do your own things and to push your own agendas and push your careers, and men must come and support you and all of that. That is very unbiblical. I'm sorry. It might stink a bit because we are Greekified. We are all unlearning. It's hard for us. We have been raised by powerful women, by leaders of the homes with absent fathers. And if I did not honor my father, I would say useless fathers, you know, and we put our mothers first. But we had to grow into this when we're learning, and we had to repent, you know. And it's not like the men are any good. There's some nonsense going on, but look, in honor of God, we have to follow his rules. I will have a little bit of more to say about this. Guys, I don't see the time. So how are we doing there with the time? Because both of these screens, somehow they're not showing the time.
Five past five. So we had 45 minutes.
Okay.
45 minutes.
Yeah. So the biggest thing here, it is that, look, women need to honor their husband. It is very evil to God when women are not honoring their husband. You know, and in my view as well, when I'm looking at even the scriptures, why God, it doesn't matter how the man is treating you. There's a way, there's ways in which you can, but do not dishonor authority. And the problem with, if you can dishonor your husband, whom God has placed as authority, who do you think is going to be next? You know, if such rebellion is allowed, the one who's next is God. And it's the first sin that goes all the way to the Garden of Eden, you know. The woman wanted to be like God. She saw it's beautiful. And the devil will always use these ways, you know. So we need to be careful. And there's ways in order to deal with these grievances. And now the king makes this decree that all women, they must honor their husband. Whether he's powerful, he's high up there, or whether he's a nobody, he's low down there. Because now this person is representing God to you. You know, you dishonor this person. You know, this is why if you dishonor, this is why one of the greatest commandments, honor your parents. It doesn't matter, it doesn't tell us whether your parents are drunkards, are abusive, or whatever. It doesn't matter. God has placed them there as an authority. And if you dishonor your parents, who's next? It is going to be God. That's an antichrist spirit. we've heard a lot of discussing that Antichrist spirit. So now this was the main thing. This is why God, this is how God was seeing it, and this is why it's in this book. It wasn't specifically mainly only just about the two of them. It's because that spirit, it is going to spread over, and now we are going to have this Antichrist spirit that women are learning to dishonor their husband. And that is not God's will. So that in application today still applies. And it's even more of a challenge for us today, because look, guys, we are living in this period where there is really a need for, I do believe in affirmative action. You know, when God was creating men and women, he was creating them to live under his rules, you know. And for women to honor the men and to be under the men, they are supposed to be following the rules. But unfortunately, the men want the women to honor them as their husbands, but they don't follow God's rules. So there was a lot of abuse in the patriarchy, and patriarchy is God's way, you know, and it will not change. But because the men are under the devil's rule, they are abusing the women, you know. So I see this also personally, in my view, this democracy and all this thing, affirmative action with power being taken from men to women, it's also a punishment for our sins. God allows it, you know. Now the men have done wrong, you know. But we must remember we are children of God. And whether high or low, we should be different. So now Vashti, after this king was healed from the pain that Vashti has caused, you know, I like it because the Bible mentioned that, and it's quite important. When I was reading it, I thought, hey, you know, there you are, you've been hurt by this woman, and some of us have got these experiences, you know. Don't just rush into the next thing, you know. You need to make a very good decision with a sober mind. And this is when he decided, you know what, he's going to look for another wife. And then he actually threw a beauty contest of virgins, you know. It's just my way to explain it, you know, so that he can choose a wife, and all these women from all the provinces and of the kingdom, from India to Africa, Alexandria, Egypt, and all the way to Greece, all the best of the beauties, you know, to come and be trained and be beautified for a long period of time so that he can come and choose the best that he will choose, you know. So this just reminds me of the way we also do it here in Africa, you know, to what the Western people called the reed dance, you know. You see, when the king wants to choose, you know, he will do this, what the Gunis will call, or the Zulus will call, umkhosi womhlanga. And the Satis just call it umhlanga, you know. So all these beautiful virgins will come and dance for the queen or for the king, and the king is going to choose the best one. And you know, yeah, this is when us were not the king, and you know, we'll be envying this guy. Somebody sent a message there. I'm not sure if it's an urgent message, but you can help me. What was the message?
No, I think it's Maureen. She's saying, next slide, please. I don't know if the first next part. Next slide, please. I just think maybe it's just the comment she's making.
On this one?
Yeah, I suppose, yes.
Oh, interesting. I think it will speak to...
I was saying, next slide, Oscar. We'll see the slide. Now you can move on.
Oh, what was... I think that will speak... I think that is an interesting comment right there. Because when... I'm very intrigued because Maureen, why did you want me to move to the next slide? I've stayed on other slides much longer than that one.
No, this one is, in our days, we don't want to see another woman's breast. So move, please.
Okay. Out of respect for Maureen, she does not want to see other women's breasts, but now I won't be able to see my notes. And it brings me maybe even to the point that I that in our today's Greasified mindset, Maureen is saying she does not want to see other women's breasts. You know, it's my view that, you see, this is what the Greeks have done to us. My next point was that when this stuff, it's actually criticized all around in our Western world. They call this nudity. In our Greasified world, it's the feminists are also coming and they're saying this is women abuse. And in my line of work, I receive a lot of complaints about that you should not show these things. And
that's what we're teaching our daughters, to say you must dress modest. Don't show off your thighs. Don't show off all these things.
Yeah. And obviously, it's because you're viewing things from the brainwashed, sorry to say that, crucified mindset. We are Africans.
And like, remember the topic you had about the pastor's wife?
Say something about it. Yeah, what about the pastor's wife?
That the pastor's wife cannot dress like.
Yes. You cannot, the ones that were dressed in short skirts and preaching in the temple, you know. In church, yes, the context there was about dressing as modest, you know. Here, this is an African. I'm shocked, and this is one of the things, because in my line of work, I receive these kind of complaints when there's these dances and we are showing them. And shockingly, and I'm glad Maureen brought this, I'm shocked when now it's not the white people, it's actually the African women, the Zulu women that are complaining. And, you know, on the other side, you know, and how I defend this in my line of work, they haven't made, what should I call them? Because I'm trying to be discreet. The tribunal, they always don't make it formal. Because me, I aggressively respond to them and to prove within our law that actually to call this nudity, it's offensive to us as Africans. This is the way we dress. you know, and we grew up watching this and we've never seen, we've never looked at the woman's things and we're thinking, oh, it's nudity, it's breast. We never, as African men, have sexual ideas when we're looking at this, you know. Our girls, they go to the things, they in Venda Day, we grew up with the young girls, when they become of age, they've got a thing that they go to. And when they come, they're moving in the streets and they're like this. We treat them with respect. And actually this it's one of the most respectful ceremonies that the Western people do not have. You know, and to call this nudity, you are insulting us. You know, you are telling us we, you know, it's that apartheid thing to say everything Western is good and everything African is bad. This year is the one that teaches our daughters to be virgins and to respect their bodies and to celebrate that thing while their people, they have been promiscuous, and anybody, when you're 16 or whatever, you can have sex with anybody, you can have whatever children. That's disgusting before God. And God will celebrate something like this because these are not promiscuous girls, you know. And none of these men, they're sitting there looking at this woman and, you know, we don't think like that, you know. And again, it's also that whole thing of an African mindset versus a European mindset. You know, us as Africans, we don't expose our bums and all those things. Now you've been crucified, you go to the beach wearing thongs and everything. That to us as Africans is nudity. But if we say it's nudity, they complain. And when there's no problem with it. But us, when we're wearing our own thingies and we, you know, they say it's nudity, and so we must accept what is crucified or what is Western. And we must take everything that is African. Now, when we go to scripture, which is which, you know, is what we're doing here in this context, you know, being, it's going to be viewed as God as something that is wrong. I don't think so, in my view, you know. But anyway, not to offend you, sorry, I forgot to remove that thing. I put it for a long time. We have to deal with this aggressified mindset. And I hate it very much because people, they've brainwashed us so much that we think everything Western is Christian. And I'm going to be dealing with this a lot in this thing, because you're gonna realize God does not even know you, because you do not receive the real God of the Jews and of the Bible. You're just taking things from the West that are just Roman and Greek.
But Oscar, our sister's point is valid. However, it is very, it's a thin line to call one thing nudity and not call that nudity. Maybe we need to call it accepted nudity. And it's not an African thing. It's a South African thing. You've got to remember, it's different. Yes. It's not the whole of Africa that does this. You've got to understand that part as well. So she has a very valid point. When is it permissible for her to dress like that? So it's only at the culture. And then if she dresses like that at the beach, then it's nudity. So it's a very big point.
I think Oscar's culture is similar to mine. A virgin girl is like that until married. When she's married, then that's when she covers up.
Listen, Rachel, you cut me short. I said, I'm not disputing to say it's a Zulu culture. I said it's South African. Listen to it's permissible here. But yes, further in other cultures, it's not permissible. Nick. So we can't now say it becomes the glory. God is saying it's okay. It's a debatable story. Not everything cultural is good. Let's just be specific.
Nick.
I get it. Yeah.
Context. I think I gave it in the context. I said, in this context of the Zulu and the African things, You cannot say that because we don't view it like that in our culture. In our culture, we're not, there's nothing pervasive. If you bring your goggles, your crucified goggles, and you're viewing this with the, then we also put our African goggles and go to the beach and see people in Pekenis, we see that as nudity. So that's what I'm saying. In this culture, we're looking at the context of what are these people in this culture doing? Are they doing some pervasive thing? No, they're not. They're actually celebrating virginity. And they're also celebrating the fact that, look, the king can choose the wife, you know? And in our culture, we don't look at children as sex objects, you know? So nobody's seeing those. Only, as Rachel was saying, once that woman is married, she needs to be covered. She must only be for her husband. So we're not saying the African culture is a godly culture, but what we're saying is the Greek mindset is not a godly culture either. So the point is, you know, that I was trying to make about that, we have got something similar to what Xerxes' pagan culture.
Xerxes is the pagan man, not a man, paganism. Let's remember that. No, I mean, it's open for, that's what I'm saying, it's open for debate. Xerxes, we cannot admire Xerxes. That is why Yahweh destroyed that nation. We cannot, and we are allowing girls to dance for one man. It's different to say, all women must dance like that for all men. You know what I mean? All I'm saying is that there is a cause for debate, and we can always take it at the Christmas party where Michelle won't be there, and we can move on. We can move on, sir. I've said my part. Thank you very much.
Okay, so I just wanted to add, Nicholas said that this is a South African thing, but Nicholas, do you know, even here we have it in Zambia. It's just that here it's very hidden. When I turned of age, you know, they took me somewhere, you know, bush area type place, and I couldn't believe the things that were happening. But my grandmother insisted that I must know my African culture. So I think in the other countries like Zambia, it's just not as prominent and open as it's done in South Africa. Like, you won't see any young girls here with their breasts out in the open, but it happens. It's just that it's very quiet. And the biggest reason is this same greasifying that's been going on. Some things are actually good. You know, there's things I learned there that I actually am using now in my marriage and in my life. But it's, you know, like Nicola said, it's open for debate later. It's a big topic. It's like culture.
We will do that. You know, I also want to remind you what I've said earlier on when we are reading this book. This is a book of the writings, guys. It's not a book of morality. You know, it's a book of wisdom. We have learned even from the previous wisdom books, even with Proverbs, that they're not from the Jews. Most of them are from Egyptians and all this, and even these pagans. Wisdom is wisdom. It's not morality. And, you know, we will take it to the, let's continue with our things. So now, the contest happens, and obviously, you know the story. Esther will be chosen. But Esther, you know, was very beautiful. She's an orphan, beautiful Jewish girl in Susa. And actually, her name was actually Hadassah. And she was raised by a relative called Mordecai, the old man there in red, from the tribe of Benjamin. So what was their relationship? I've asked even on WhatsApp group. What was the relationship?
They were cousins.
They're cousins. The Bible says cousin.
Yeah, and on the WhatsApp group, I've asked the person who said cousins, because everywhere, every single preacher I've heard said Mordecai is Esther's uncle. And even in all those movies, not even one of them says cousins. And I'm like, where does it say in the Bible that they were cousins? Where does it say that in the Bible?
Mordecai, it does say, I'll read it for you. Mordecai, it says in the CJV that the...
Where?
I'll show you. Let me read it while you do that. I'll find it. Give me a sec. They were cousins, and then he adopted her later. I'll show you.
Okay. I'm going to have it just now on screen. But what I was trying to find out is that, did you read your Bible or you are just taking things? Because I've been saying this thing of mother of Esther and
no, we read
Mordecai for a long time. So I wanted someone to show me that they're actually reading and they're just not taking what I keep saying. So it is actually there, you know, in 2 verse 7, you see that Hadassah was the daughter of his uncle. So what is the daughter of your uncle?
Cousin.
It's your cousin, you know. And there it is, she had a beautiful figure and was lovely to look at.
And NLT always, actually yeah. says cousin, Oscar, NLT.
I like it that's says, what...
This man had a very beautiful and lovely young cousin. It says cousin.
Yeah. You know, NLT, it's a translation that I always recommend for people who are starting to read the Bible. You know, it may not be as accurate as ESV and others, but NLT, I read NLT almost my whole entire life because it speaks the language that you understand. It's a New Living Translation. It makes it so once you read that, you're never gonna have these funny errors when you're reading the NLT. You know, it uses your language. It paraphrases as well. So thank you for reminding me of the NLT. But look, Esther had a beautiful figure. The Bible is saying that. So these things you cannot ignore. You cannot just pass them and you know. And because you are gracified mindset, you know, wants to take things of the physical as if they're not important, they're not spiritual, they're not, you can't separate spiritual from the physical. You will learn when we deal with it. In that 400 years after Malika, you know. And these things are important, you know, because these are the things that God is using in his kingdom, using her figure, he gave her that figure and to be beautiful, to use, to do something that probably even the prophets and the kings couldn't have been able to do, just that figure and that beautiful face. You know, and it will be pinching to a crucified mindset that will deal with it some other time. And verse 15 as well still says it. So I don't know how people miss this because it keeps saying one of the same thing. Where do they get this thing of Uncle Mordecai to Esther? I don't get it. I don't get it. It goes to show people don't read the Bibles. When someone says one thing, it just spreads and everybody just listens to preachers. And that's what happened in our Greek world. We don't see scripture something that we must read. We listen to all these superstars and entertainers and, you know, and once that powerful man of God has said something, everybody's just gonna repeat it. And it's really quite annoying. It shows people don't read the Bible. You know, and I've also asked, and someone answered correctly, what is missing in this book of Esther, which you usually just find in almost all the books? It was also, I think, missing in one of the books that we read. Mm-hmm. What is missing?
It's not. It's not mentioning anything about the kingdom of God. It well, at least I didn't get that. I just feel it's a story, not necessarily telling us about the kingdom of God like any other 5-4 books that we've read in the past 2 weeks.
It's close, but I'll say, in a way, it does tell us about the kingdom of God. Because remember, the kingdom of God has been the kingdom of the Jews. So there is a lot about the Jews in this and their kingdom. Yeah, you are right, Michelle. The main thing is it's not mentioning God himself, Yahweh. You know, in all the books, Yahweh, it's Yahweh here and there, yeah, you know, he's the one, but yeah, there's no mentioning, not even once. You know, so it's one of those things when I was also reading it, I was like, hey, what's happening? And then it clicked on my mind, look, this is a writing, you know, and the writings, you know, just like poetry and all music and all that, this it portrays the message of the heart. You know, that's what one thing that I, you know, we'll also deal with this thing when we're dealing with the crucification, about separating the flesh and the spirit and the soul and the so-called soul. But God is interested in all these areas and the language of the heart, guys, you know, these love stories. And Michelle, when you were saying that when you're reading this book, you are caught up in the, how did you put it? You're caught up in the
thing caught between, up in the relationship between Xerxes and Esther.
Yes, that was love the whole stories. Point. That was the whole point. If you are not caught up in that, then you're not getting the actual message of this book. You know, because that's what even the writings are all about. You're supposed to get the feeling and be taken by that love thing, the way they're talking, the way they're communicating, the way they're doing things, the way they're falling in love, the way love is moving all these things to make them do this, and the whole drama when it's someone is about to get into trouble. Then, you know, that whole thing, that's what this thing is supposed to, that whole drama. This is why you see even the prophets, God will now even make them write things in poetry and also make them do all those dramatic things because he's trying to explain the feelings. Feelings are very important. Emotions are very important. We communicate with them, and God communicates as well with these things. They're not just the way we only need to read with the head and get the, like in history books and in other. No, God wants everything. And this is where we're getting this story. The, you know, the Mordecai getting angry because that one dishonored him, and then he has to go and, you know, he's devastated and he has to heal and get, you know, and trying to get someone, will he get someone that is correct for him? And, you know, will he still get someone beautiful? Will he still get, because he had a beautiful woman, will still get to fall in love? Will he still have, because a man without a woman is useless. It's sorry to use that word, but, you know, it's not good. There's nothing good about a man. Will he get that? Because we try to see this, you know, will be this man be redeemed after being humiliated, and this woman, and she's coming as the right one, and then all of a sudden this drama, someone is gonna try to kill them, then, you know, the king does it, and this, and it actually even solved the problems that I had with this Mordecai. And by the way, even if it's not explicitly telling us that God, somehow you can see certain things that we've seen previously being done by God. God is the one who causes someone to have favor with someone to fall in love with someone. So this, falling in love is not a work of the devil. You know, we can be obsessed and go other ways, and, you know, but falling in love is a beautiful thing. It's created by God, attraction. You know, It's not a secular thing. It's not a thing that came with it. It's created by God. Women and men and women, when they're attracted, and this, I mean, could, you know, that guy that you're looking for, whatever, if God makes you someone to fall in love and to love you, embrace that stuff. It's not an easy thing. And that's why love needs to keep burning, even in a marriage. A marriage without love is dead. It's useless. You know, I don't believe in divorce. The Bible doesn't allow it. You know, but just as it is when you are married to a woman who's, as the wisdom book say, who's quarrelsome, it's better to live alone in the on top of the roof there and be exposed to all sorts of weathers, rains and suns and everything, than to live with such a person. God has not created us to live in these horrible conditions just to get married and make children and just to, no, there has to be love. There has to be that thing between men and God has created us. If he gets excited to it, he wants to see it. He's driving this stuff. I remember even when we're reading the in Judges, how he, it was God who actually, look how you're going to hate this God if you don't want to see him for who he is. It was God who made Samson to love Delilah and all those women from that were forbidden. It was God. It says it directly. So you cannot, God is involved in these things. You know, people in love, don't just rush them to go and make wise decisions of the head only or whatever, or think there's no God in it, or just people just end up with each other just because we are believers. We are believers. No, love is important, you know. And when you're in love, and men, we're supposed to be in love. Women are supposed to be in love. It's God who created that stuff. So God causes favor. So it may not be said explicitly mentioned, but we can see, and we'll see even in later on that some stuff. No. Some stuff that is happening. There are two coincidental. God has to be running these things. We've seen throughout the Tanakh that God is actually the one actually pulling the strings in history. You know, when this Haman come into the picture and the things that happen, let me just go quickly so that we may end up covering them.
Oscar, you got 20 minutes.
No, I've got the time now. I actually stopped the phone from, So now, you know the story, you know, Esther wins the contest, she becomes queen, you know, and this is the original Cinderella story. You know, there's nothing as powerful, you know, as a love story between a beautiful, well-mannered and poor girl, guys, with a rich, powerful man. You know, we've seen it with Solomon and Song of Songs. We've seen it with Ruth. You know, these stories, they make beautiful, the opposite attracting, the power of a woman, the beauty, and her manners, the way she honors a man. She gives glory to that man. And a woman is the glory of man. A woman who respects a man and makes him feel like he's king and brings glory to him. He walks around proud, showing her off that this is my woman, you know. It is beautiful in God's eyes. You know, we are not leaving these stories to the sinners out there who are doing these things on TV and rom-coms. They've got twisted things. You know, this is ours as well. We must own this thing. This is what God has created us for. You know, in the end, when the new kingdom comes, these things will be gone. Let us enjoy them. The angels are envying us because we've got these things. They don't have women. You know, some of them even messed up because they were seen. That's how powerful the beautiful women are. You know, the women decided even to go against God and to, you know, because they're seeing the women, they, you know. Today, of course, you know, Satan has, you know, as I've said, I believe in affirmative action, but Satan always used that deception to deceive the women. Now he's giving them this false power offering them riches and everything and taking power from the men. And today the men are without money and power. Because when men have got money, men, they like to shower their women. You know, now if the women have got money and there's nobody to shower you with that thing, it's unnatural. And you have to shower a man with, or you know, it's something that is not really. And it's, by the way, it's leading, this is one of the things that are leading to divorces. We've done actually a thing on this, that you know, a live discussion on this with facts, that 70% of the divorces are actually initiated by women. And the facts are showing that it's, you know, one of the reasons is this economic empowerment. It's like one of the main reasons. So it's like, you know, I've learned something called the Cobra effect. I'm not going to go into it, but it's one of those things that look like they're solving a problem, but they're bringing 10 more problems. You know, now children have been grown in single mothers and single, and they don't have families, and they don't have fathers, and it's all these sort of things that this whole thing is causing. But the original story, it's powerful. And it's good as long as the man is a righteous man. When a man is not righteous, oh, these other things are even better. They may not be of God, but they're even better. Because the man will abuse, the man will use that power to even cause that woman that he said he loved to. There's many other women that are involved, you know, and there's all these sort of things. But when a man fears God and is working under the authority of God, and he knows that he has to do everything for this woman, shower her, keep that beauty that he has found, you know, keep that love. She needs to know that she's beautiful. That's why women, you enjoy this stuff. You are created, it's inside of you. Now, when your man is not proud of you, he's starting to tell you that you're beautiful. And he's looking at you, you know, you're not good. But now when he's saying it mustn't show you off, it's women abuse, you know, what is that? I'm created to be beautiful and for your beauty to be showed off. And that's why this story is so romantic and so interesting, you know. And moving right along. Now, what is the meaning of this Esther? What is Esther? Quickly, guys. Her real name was Hadassah.
Isn't Esther a goddess?
Well, it is.
A Babylonian.
And that is a big problem. Because it's derived from the word, yeah. Which means a star, Saturn, and it is, yes, the same name as Ishtar, you know? And Ishtar, as we know, is that same Asherah of the Jezebel, the moon goddess, we studied from the Tower of Babel, you know? And yes, it's also this Ishtar that's not me. I don't have anything to do with Easter and Christmas. I'm going to discuss them even in this week. They are very pagan. There's nothing Christian about them. They have nothing to do with Christ. They're just wicked things of these demons, or these probably fallen angels, or these wicked evil spirits that are calling themselves goddesses appearing to people. So now, why will this Jewish woman, Hadassah, be renamed Esther? Jewish people, they usually will not defile themselves or go and do something to name themselves with this something that blasphemes. So why will this woman, how did this name come about? You know? It's Mordecai, probably Mordecai, who raised her. And this is why when I kept reading, I had serious problem with this Mordecai, because in my mindset, I was reading it at first as a moral book. And I was finding this Mordecai being a very bad man. And I'll tell you why, because now, first of all, I'm seeing his renaming this girl. Something a Jew will never do. Especially these free Jews in the under the Persian Empire. You know, and if he was a good man, now this is the point. These people, they've been released. Zerubbabel has went to Jerusalem. Why is this man remaining here? Why are these people remaining here if they're good people? Why shouldn't they be rebuilding the temple? Why are they staying here in this pagan world? This Mordecai, I had serious problem with him. He's sitting there at the king's gate, he's enjoying, you know, he's enjoying this royal treatment. That's one of those, they don't want to go and start and worship God. They're enjoying these things that they're getting here in what, let me call it, Babylon, you know. And as we've discussed in detail last week, why these people would did not go back, you know. And he changed this girl's name, and he's the one who actually sent her there to go and marry a pagan king. Something that is also something that is also not allowed by God. It's sinful. How can this man be a good man? I was reading this book as a book of morality, you know, not as a wisdom book. And I kept it. And then when she was there, he kept coming to see it. He was like pimping her, monitoring and grooming her. And he was going then, you know, I'm like, what is this man doing? What kind of a man is this? We know, we saw that this girl is beautiful and whatever. It's like, he's gonna use her to. No, I was having a serious problem, but Mordecai was wise. And what he was doing was wise. And we've seen it worked throughout this book. It worked to the advantage of the other Jews, not only those Jews that were there, who were remaining there in Susa and other provinces, and other Israelites. It worked even for those ones that were there rebuilding the temple, because as long as there's someone favoring the Jews, as long as the King of Kings is favoring the Jews, something that they never had until Darius. And actually, Darius was not even favoring the Jews. He did it to all the other nations to allow them to go to their countries, because he was doing it for himself, for them to fail to, you know. But this kind of favor, now we've got hope. And it was brought in by this woman and by the wisdom of this old man. Wisdom is always, it's not always moral. We've discussed this when we're discussing that man, when the wicked man that Jesus actually praised, that servant, you know, that manager, that shrewd, it's even called a shrewd manager. And Jesus is commending him and he's saying, these people of the world are even wiser than us, the children. And, you know, and wisdom is wisdom, guys. Does not necessarily have to be moral. So it helped me when I remembered what kind of a book I'm reading. So we've already read that this man is a Benjamite, you know, and he was carried, and his great grandfather was carried with Jeconiah. Who was Jeconiah? Remember Jeconiah? Who did we say Jeconiah was in our last? Who's Jeconiah? We read about him even in Daniel.
He was a king in the line of David.
Which deportation was it? Was it taken from?
It's not the last one.
No, the last one
was the first one.
No, the first one was Jehoiakim. It means you're left with only one. So this is Jeconiah is Jehoiakim. So we've discussed that in Daniel, guys. We said, remember these two names. And then you realize that also in Matthew 1, those who were there last week realized they used that word Jeconiah. Jeconiah and Joachim is the same person. Joachim was the first one on the first deportation. All right. Now, we come to the drama now. Now I'm going to have to move very fast because anyway, you know the whole story. The king promotes this one Haman who was an Agagite, and he honored him, and everybody needs to, you know, to pay homage to this guy. You know, just like the king, when the king passes, you respect him, you show his respect by bowing to him. You know, was that a wrong thing? Was that a wrong thing? Anybody?
Well, the king ordered that everyone must do that. So it was by the order of the king.
Yes, I'm saying, was it wrong? Was it wrong that people had to bow down?
He was disobeying the king. So I would say it was wrong. He was disobeying the king. My point is this.
Who was disobeying the king?
Mordecai.
Who was this? Yeah. There it is. That is very important. That's another thing that pissed me off with this Mordecai guy. I'm like, why is he not bowing? Why? There's absolute no reason. Why is he not bowing to this guy?
And you see, Oscar, on that one, they decided to stay behind. So staying behind, you must obey where you decided to stay behind.
Yeah, and look, this, and God wants you to obey these rules, as long as they're not conflicting any laws of God, and they're not. And that's why he tells us, even us, yeah, we must obey the government's rules, because he has placed them in power. Even these pagans, he has placed them in power. And we must honor when the premier comes here, you know, I can't treat him like it. I must honor him. But why is this Mordecai doing this? It's one of the things. And please, can someone read this? Where's our reader? Smangeli, please read this next verse. Quickly. Oh, Nick, can you read it for us?
Okay.
Sorry, I was on mute. I didn't realize I was on mute.
Okay.
And when Haman saw that Mordecai did not bow down or pay homage to him, Haman was filled with fury, but he disdained to lay hands on Mordecai alone, as they had made known to him that people of Mordecai, as they had made known to him the people of Mordecai, Haman sought to destroy all the Jews, the people of Mordecai throughout the whole kingdom of in the Ahasuerus.
Yeah, just say Zexis. I also struggle pronouncing that. This is what pissed me off in this world, that if Mordecai has just bowed, there was not going to be any drama, any problem. This man did not bow, and then that's when Haman was told all this. So that movie and these movies, which show us as if Haman had issues with the Jews and because he was an Agagite and he's got beef. No, the Bible never told us those things. People are just throwing in their inferences. Haman did not have any issues until this man disobeyed, and then that's when he's finding out that that man is, it's like, no, you know what, I'm not gonna do him alone. I'm going to. So it's because of Haman that now everybody's going to be destroyed. This Mordecai, because of Mordecai, he's causing problems. He's loving things. He's disobeying. I'm like, he's the troublemaker here, bringing all this problem. Now this Haman is gonna go and destroy the Jews. And then this is when Haman goes and he casts the Lord's called Par, you know, and that was from the first month. And the first month of the Jewish calendar, it's Nisan. And only on the 12th month, that's when, you know, the Lord said, yeah, now it's time. And a casting, for it, to cut the long story short, is casting lots is the same as what they're doing, like the diviners, like sangomas, throwing their bones so that the demons can tell them when is their lucky time to do this evil thing that they want to do. You know, so they've been casting and the demons were not saying, and only in the month of Adar, see, Nisan is their first month, somewhere around March and April. And then for all these 12 months, the demons were not saying anything. And in Adar, when they're casting lots, they say, ah, now you can destroy the Jews. And it's very interesting. This is why I said God actually was also behind this, even though he was not explicitly mentioned. You know, because this is the month when we've got 2 minutes. I need to move fast. And it means I'm going to have to move fast. And the NLT will tell you that it's March there. And he goes and he convinces the king, and the king gives him his signet ring, you know, that whatever has got a signature of a king, king of kings, it's done. And then this man decides that, yeah, you know, that he's even going to hang Mordecai, you know, and the papers, they go all around, everywhere. Everywhere in the empire, even Jerusalem and India and everywhere, to say, hey, the Jews, they need to be dealt with, they need to be destroyed. And Haman is going to pay whoever is going to do it. And then Mordecai sends Mordecai sends the message to Esther, and Esther hears about it. And now, you know, because God has laid that favor, she does something that would have got Vashti to be killed, to come before the king, not summoned. And when, but the king lifted a scepter to allow her. And then she humbly, she does the show, that character that we discussed. And the king said, what can I, you know, give you? Whatever I can give you, up to half the kingdom. And then the king, and she says, if it pleases the king, please, can we have the feast? So she plans this few days of feast. In the first day, she says, you and Haman as well, come. And Haman was so excited on the first day he had. And he goes and he tells his wife as well, that, yo, the queen invited me, and even tomorrow there's another feast, she has invited me. That's how important I am. I mean, look, I've got all this, I've got the ring, I've been given all these things, you know. And then he says to the wife, you know, all these things, they mean nothing to me, all this glory, all these riches, and they mean nothing because there's this one man, you know, who actually despised me. And the wife said to him, look, just hang this man tomorrow. And he decided, you know what? I'm going to do it. But that night, of course, the king had, now this is where you see God with dreams. We've seen it with Nebuchadnezzar and them. Xerxes got a dream, accidentally, in inverted commas, and he decides to honor the man who has actually helped him, and because some eunuchs plotted to kill the king, and Mordecai had it, and he went and he reported, but nothing was done for him. So he decides he's going to honor this person. So now when this guy comes to the feast, Haman, the following day, he had planned, he had made a thing to hang Mordecai. I'm going to move very fast. You know the story. But the king tells him that, hey, this man was not being honored. What shall I do for this man? He thought he was talking about himself. So he said he must be honored, must be put on royal robes and all of that. And then, as you know, this Haman was made to put Mordecai on the king's horse and in royal robes, and to declare him and to honor him across the street instead of hanging him. You know, so, you know, the preachers are not wrong in preaching that God, you know, can make what the enemy has planned for you to destroy you and to use it against your enemy. This is what these books are written in. Wisdom books, we do put ourselves in. And these other stories, we don't put ourselves in. They're not written for that. Yeah, so you know the story. I'm not going to, you know, Mordecai ends up being hanged on it and his house was given to Esther. I'm not going to take more than 5 minutes. And the king also gives Esther power and allowed her to kill Mordecai and his 7 sons and to hang them, which morally for me did not look what like a good thing, but within this story, the enemy of God and, you know, and the agitator to be destroyed in any way, they're supposed to be destroyed fully in the book of Judges. And they were all destroyed here, and we thank God for it. And the Jews now, they were allowed to kill anybody who was trying to attack them, and the Jews were saved even there in Jerusalem where the temple was being built. And we are going to continue next week to learn about how the Jews continue to rebuild the temple and they became what they are today. But what is even more important today, even today, the Jews, they celebrate this day, you know, and they call it the Purim, you know. So and every 14th day of the Adar, which is, we just had load shedding, which is the month of, they celebrate this. And what is Adar? To cut the long story short, Adar, it's actually from the word pur, which actually, the Purim. It comes from that word pur, which is the Lord that Haman was trying to cast so that they may destroy the Jews. It was turned over. Let me end up here. I think the other, I'll leave the other. Guys, can you hear me? Hello?
Yes.
Okay, yeah, I'll end up here. So at least you know about the Purim holiday, which the Jews started celebrating from that day. And to show that this is not, it's not fiction, it's a true story as well. So I'll end up here and open up for any questions or comments. And they live happily ever after, but the king died, obviously. But yeah.
Oscar, I still don't understand how God allowed a Jew to get married to a pagan king. That's what baffled me with this story. I couldn't understand it.
I did mention it. It's not a moral story, a moral book, this one. We're not supposed to look at it to try and find the morality out of it, but the wisdom out of it to say, no, God did allow it. And I gave an example. He did. He was also behind the marriage of Samson and the Philistine woman who also even betrayed him. So God is still God. He can do anything that he wants. You know, the rules apply to us. But we were not, it was not written for us to learn those kind of things. You know, so it's not condoning it. So if we allowed it, but he still worked his power on it, he did. And that's what we learned, that by God's wisdom, you know, God made all things work out to good for his children, regardless of what they did is right or wrong. He used her beauty, he used to save all people. When they decided to fast and pray, and God did listen to them, no matter how sinful they were. That's my view.
That question that she asked, I got sidetracked a bit when I was studying this. There have been very many Jews in history that have also thought that this should not have been included in the canonization purely because of those things. You know, and even one of our very most controversial, Martin Luther, was also opposing this, but obviously we can't take anything seriously from Martin Luther. You know, so yeah, there's just many things also when I look at it about this book. It's a very nice story. And like what you're saying, Oscar, I see a lot of I think you can look at it and say you see the sovereignty of God, that he still can use any avenue that he wants to use to achieve a certain purpose, you know. Mm-hmm. So yeah.
Yes, I am. You're very right. This book has been debated a lot. They try to get rid of it, but that's why it's still even the God wants it there. And it is the sovereignty of God. God will say, well, I'll save whoever I save. And look, God is God. He will say, don't kill, but then he sends you to kill. And Saul did not kill, and then he kills Saul, never forgives Saul. And then he loves the David whom he has sent to kill so many people. So whatever God says goes, and whatever he, you know, God is sovereign. And, but this is not a book of morality. If you look at it from a moral point of view, you're going to mess up things. It's not written for that. You know, so this is why context of the book is very important. Any other question or comment? Maureen, is Maureen still there? Okay, guys, in the absence of somebody's trying to say something.
Sorry, hi, I have a question. Nick, you mentioned Martin Luther. What was Martin Luther's concern about the Book of Esther?
One of the points he raised was, okay, the fact that also he mentioned that there's no mentioning of Yahweh and of prayer. And then another point he mentions was also to say, if this act was so significant, why didn't the other patriots mention it? And then also, it's never been quoted by any of the New Testament people. It's never been quoted by anyone in the other books. And then also, he also mentions that the timing is wrong, because in some versions of the Bible, they allude to the fact that Mordecai came with that exile, implying that he's 90, and the mathematics didn't add on. And eventually said one of his key points was just, no, it's just a book, that's just to glorify the Jews. That's all. There's no mention of God. They just want to make themselves look important. Those were one of his key, those were his points.
Yeah, no, I think he made an error when calculating the years of Mordecai. I also made that error, and only to realize that actually that scripture was speaking about his great-grandfather. And Martin Luther, you must be careful with him. Martin Luther is also, I used to love the guy. He was one of my heroes. But the more I read the Bible and I studied, I realized that Martin Luther was more of an antichrist as well. He was also possessed with an antichrist spirit of hyper grace as well. He wanted to get rid as well of the book of Revelation and James and all these things, whatever he finds where it's not, there's no grace. He does not want that angry God and a God who punishes sin. And he also wanted to entirely get rid of the Old Testament. you know, because he was onto this hyper grace of his. So, you know, he started off well, but he went crazy with hyper grace. So, you know, and as so with many other people from who were Gnostics from the Western world. So this is why when we read scripture, you know, we need to go with what the Jews are saying. These Western people, they're too greasified. But whatever scripture says, it goes. Any other thing?
So our walk away from this, from the study of Esther, is what? What is the true reason this Esther book is in the Bible?
It's the story about love, the story about how God used love to save his people. It's as simple as that. It's a love story. That's it. You know, you don't study it. Don't study it like you it's a wisdom book. It's don't study it like you're studying the book of prophets or the Torah or you're trying to, you know, that stuff that you got when you're watching.
Too much into it.
Say what?
I'm saying, in other words, we mustn't read too much into it.
Don't read much into it. You know, see the sovereignty of God that, look, God did not always use soldiers and angels and whatever. And just simple thing, love.
Mm.
You know, God is an architect. Use love to save. Otherwise, these people, if it wasn't of Esther, the Jews would have been completely destroyed and wouldn't be having the Messiah. We are busy looking at Ezra, at Zerubbabel and Yeshua. The things are happening there. The kingdom is coming. Now we can. And then all of a sudden, the devil wants to get rid of all the Jews. And you must also look at it from the Jewish point of view. Now they've got this thing which they celebrate, the same thing that they do with the Passover. You know, they've got something to worship God about. They remember where God. So now when they go through things like the Holocaust, for instance, they're able to read that book and understand, look, the God who has saved us from the Egyptians, and we've got so Passover. The same God that has saved us from the Persians, and we've got the Purim. Don't read it like a Western person or like a non-Jewish person. These are Jewish books. They need to be read from a Jewish point of view.
Yeah, Oscar, I was about to make that point. That's a very good point, because the way the Jews celebrate it is that during that Feast of Purim, where they take time to reflect how God saved them from that annihilation. And then one thing we should remember is that at that particular time, that kingdom of Xerxes was from India all the way to Egypt. So you're looking, and then that decree that he wanted to, that was achieved by his dubious means to convince the king to use a seal, that one said that anyone can attack them from India all the way to Egypt. That means the total annihilation of that tribe. And then that if you annihilate that tribe, there is no Yeshua. So when they remember it in the Feast of Purim, they remember that time to say, you saved us from all that. And if that had to happen, there would have been no rebuilding of, or the temple would have been destroyed earlier. It would have been a total mess. So that's the angle from the Jewish perspective that we have to learn to look at things these days. We have to look at it from that perspective, and then we see the bigger light. Then we see the sovereignty of God, how there's something that Mordecai said, that's a very powerful statement that, you know, these grace preachers used to always use, but it's a powerful statement when he told Hadassah to say, if you don't come through now and do something now, you will perish, but do not be mistaken, because salvation of the Jews will come from another direction. You know, so that was also another belief that whatever happens, we will survive because of the promise that our forefathers read to us, that there will be a king that will sit on the throne of David. So, and Satan's plan has always been to stop that thing from coming to existence. So if you look at it from that thing, it becomes an amazing book, whether it's true, because another aspect that that we didn't really touch on, when Mordecai made that decree, because remember, when the kings make a decree, they can't reverse it. So the time that Xerxes knew that his wife might be killed again, sorrow filled him because there was no way to protect his wife because he had already made a decree. So by adding that decree to say the Jews must defend themselves, what it actually meant was that, you know, now the Jews can fight. But if you read scripture, it says a lot of people converted to become Jews for the fear of Jews and especially of Mordecai. Mordecai was a very shrewd man and they feared him. So to fear being killed, you know, because now they could defend themselves, they had to become Jewish. So that just shows you how God is just sovereign in his way. Even if that man was shrewd and used funny tactics and convinced his cousin to become, you know, to change the name, there was still the sovereignty of God. And if we want to be crucified and be like one of those, you know, grace preachers, then we can say, we can look at our lives and say, even us, we must take courage in knowing that we serve a sovereign God, that we can trust him and we can walk away from stop decreeing and declaring and being mini gods and trust that our Yahweh, Adonai Svahut, the God of heaven's armies, he will have his way if we just trust him. I ended it.
Even in our own mistakes, even in our own wickedness, God is still able to turn that which was evil and make it good. God is sovereign, guys. You know. Yeah, guys. I should allow those who wanted to leave or otherwise, if there's no more, let's just close in prayer.
After we close in prayer, can we, those who can stay behind and help us do that test run for next week, please stay behind.
I just had load shedding as well.
Oh, okay. No, then we'll do it on our own. We'll find time, Oscar.
Yeah, we'll find time.
Okay.
Okay. What we can do, we can also just stay in to finalize the social. Just 2 minutes, Inji. All right, can you close for us in prayer, Mwamba? Oh, is she gone? Oh, okay, Michelle is gone. Yeah, John, you can close for us. Oh, Karen, are you there? Okay, thank you.
Father, we thank you. We honor you today. We give you glory, praise, adoration. As we are coming together in fellowship to learn of you, of your works, to learn of your word, to learn of your sovereignty over all nations, over all tribes, over all peoples, to learn of how you save your people, to learn of how you are moving to make the kingdom of Christ, the kingdom of Yeshua, our Lord and Savior, a reality on earth. We thank you, mighty Father, that you have gathered us again today and that you've been with us throughout the week, that, Father, you are depositing a wisdom in our minds, in our hearts, to be able to move on this earth in realization of what you are doing in the kingdom of Christ. We thank you, Lord, for Brother Oscar and for the commitment that you have put into his heart to be able to learn and to teach and to help us unlearn all the things that are coming from the crucified world. We pray that God let this work be strengthened, let his hand be strengthened, and help us all, my Father, that we may not become weary. In the mighty name of our Lord and our Savior Jesus, we pray, be with us in the coming week and with our families and meet all our needs. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. And guys, remember,